I'm a digital arts major, a marketing minor.
I am.
Or I was the station manager of What Radio the past year.
I'm really, really proud of everything we're able to do. That had a network, all that good stuff.
I'm also a member and director at the Titanic Players Improv Comedy here at Stetson, which I really love. But like a lot of students, I don't think that my organizations necessarily describe me to the fullest extent. So here's a couple of things that I like to do. Now, honestly, I may have some form of obsessive compulsive disorder. I have a lot of symptoms similar to that, but was never diagnosed as a kid. That's not what this is about. Also, if there's a doctor, this is a concern. Close this. So I started exhibiting symptoms of Tourette's syndrome when I was about 11 years old, and at that time, I was entering middle school. Yeah, middle school is awesome. I had two girlfriends. I started wearing jeans. Yeah.
Exactly.
That's actually it for middle school. But also, I don't know these children, but I can relate. So what is Tourette's syndrome? Okay, it's a neurological disorder. It's characterized by tics, or sudden repetitive actions or utterances that someone with Tourette's syndrome has to do every couple seconds. I had my first tic in sixth grade, and I just started just gasping all the time. It was really weird, but I don't know, I just did it. It's neurological disorder with onset in childhood. I don't have my God voice on.
There it is. Is that weird? Whoa. I'm gonna turn that off.
Okay. Yeah. And then next, yeah, it's multiple motor tics or physical actions and vocal tics or utterances are required over the course of a year to be classified specifically as Tourette's. Otherwise, it might be some other general tic disorder. But let's see here. So a lot of people wonder if these tics are involuntary, because they definitely seem to be. It depends on the person. For me, no. That's because I experience premonitory urges. These are little undesirable or sometimes irresistible signals sent to muscle groups in my body telling me to perform these actions. And because of that, a lot of scientific journals have started using the term involuntary. That's going to show up. Involuntary. There you go. Now, I can just say no to these urges that I feel, and that's called suppression. I do that a lot. I'm doing it right now. I do it when I have conversations with people or if I'm in classrooms just because I don't want to instruct people. And I'm much better at suppressing tics now than I was as a kid. The urges are diminished at this point because it usually goes away as you get older. So a lot of times when I was a kid, I would just describe the way the urges feel. I would just say that they suck, that they blow. But if I had to be a little bit more creative about the graduate college, I would say that it feels somewhere between, halfway point, between the intangible feeling of peer pressure and the more physical, stressful feeling of holding your breath. So try to combine those and put it like in your arm. And then, oh, gotta do this. So, at the beginning of my senior research this year, I posed a question to myself. I said, what of the sound list is lost? As a digital artist, my primary focus includes trying to make audio representations or translations of things that don't exist sonically, things that don't have a voice, like disorder, or just, I don't know, something else. Sometimes I've made a piece that sounds like what a thought sounds like, if you just have a thought. I don't know. So, it is a form, yeah. So, to me, sight has trained us to measure the world on scales and scrutinize the numbers. But sound is delivered in units of consideration, at least to me. It's our most immaterial sense. We don't see numbers or factors when we listen. We just listen. And it just comes in. And you don't even see sound. It just comes to you. So I feel it's a really good system to deliver
meanings, like personal concepts, experiences, notions. With that in mind, I would like to perform my first live piece today. It is a sonic translation of Tourette syndrome. So my goal with this piece is to successfully translate the emotional relationship that I have with my tics to you, the audience, using adverse or undesirable sound, very similar to the undesirable urges that I feel. Yeah. Yeah, there we go, tics to sound. Changes in appetite, energy levels, or even personality. I had a bit of a personality change. So I've chosen to stay off of them, but I will admit their benefits would have been very, very helpful this semester. It's hard to graduate. So what is it like? Well, I have crafted a very simple acronym to remember, to help you remember. And it is DPAT Falpots. Ahoy! Difficulty. Paying attention to things. For a longer period of time, sometimes. Also, hyper. Oh, yeah! So I'm much older now, and I have a lot of experience handling this disorder off of medication. But I still find myself suddenly looking up in class or in a conversation, and I realize I have no idea what happened in the last minute. I was in my own little bubble, a little thought bubble, weird train of thought. I just go to 7 steps. So let's run through one of those right now. This is an average thought process that I might have with ADHD.
So I'll be in improv rehearsal. We're talking about two-person scenes and what they do. And he'll say relationships. Suddenly my mind goes, well, Brandon, relationship, he acted weird to me today. And we used to play Smash Brothers. I need to play Gears of War with Casey. He did the dish. Oh, no, I have to do the trash. That episode of Sunny, remember the one about the trash? I'm just thinking about garbage now. That's not helpful. That's not useful in a class. That's almost never useful in a classroom setting. Unless the classroom is about garbage. So I'm not as embarrassed about ADHD as I am Tourette's, mainly because I don't like to bother people. So I felt like my attention class bothered people a lot. ADHD seems like it doesn't really bother people the same way, except for maybe my loving parents and grandparents. Thank you so much for not treating me out at the hospital. So are there benefits to this disorder? I would say definitely, maybe. First off, I'm a born multitasker. I have a cool little thing I can do. I can separate my physical self and focus and my mental focus, and I can maybe do the dishes while you're talking to me, and I'll actually be able to focus on that, on you. So thank you, Fidget Cube. Or placebo effect, I don't know yet. Not sure, but they are $5 on eBay, so it doesn't hurt. Another thing, I can hype people. I'm very good at like explaining how excited I am about exciting things. So that's neat. Additionally, my memory is improving because I'm so observant and I'm just like looking around, you know. So yeah, I'm more observant now. I'm paying better attention to details. What else? My memory is doing great because I'm looking around. Yeah, I'm more observant now. Okay, I'm paying more attention to details. But the real question is, are there any benefits to this? I would say definitely. Maybe. First off, my memory is improving dramatically. I'm paying attention. Okay. So growing up with these disorders. I really hated the feeling of being out of control, or people thinking I was, or just not being in control of myself. I hated being weird, I guess. But I thought people were looking at my tics in class or just getting really bothered by it, writing off their own judgments that I was just weird and forgetting about me, and I can't change their mind. So that really bothered me as a kid. But college fixed that right up. Although I don't think these people are in college. They look like their moms. Okay. I picked Stetson because it's weird. I went here and I was like, these people are like a little weird. It's cool. I like it. The faculty is weird too. Like, you go to Stetson and people look kind of like this. Or like this. Okay, I'll give you some more like this. Okay. So in a lot of ways, Stetson let me embrace this weirdness in a really creative and passionate way. I started noticing other people's problems. I started talking about my issues instead of getting defensive the moment they came up or if anyone ever talked about my tics. I started learning about different disorders or things I never had to go through. Parents divorce, racism, sexism, things that I don't have a lot of experience with. So that was really helpful, and I thank Stetson and the faculty members and everyone for that. So the name of this is called Boogeyman Hosted. This is the original name, Boogeyman Hosted Shiver. The reason for that is because it's an anagram for my thesis statement. And an anagram means it has the same letters. This is my thesis statement. Everybody has some. Because everyone, let's see here. This is probably the strongest lesson I learned at Stetson. I learned that it's hard to define yourself, and that, I mean, just this semester, I have bounced back and forth, like, personally, about being like, am I a narcissist, am I an empath, am I a sociopath, or am I just a weirdo? And that's where I stopped. Because I think I am very weird. Because I think everyone is very weird. No one is born with a normal brain. Everyone's weird. I like it. It's cool. It's cool to think that, and I'm going off script. Okay. I don't need to strive to become normal, because everyone is weird. Being weird is just being truthful to an extent. Also, for those of you who don't believe me. And also, like Boogeyman is Tourette's, I'm hosting it, Shivery is like, you know, tics. I thought it was cool. Okay, now I want to perform my second live piece today, which is actually more of a game. It's a live simulation of ADHD. And I'm going to pass out some things. Or good, Casey, can you help me pass it? So I went to the dollar store and I got all of these supplies, but it only came with 15 sticks. So, Dr. Wallach, there you are. Thank you for helping me out this semester and being my mentor. So I give you the grandest stick. Okay, so live simulation of ADHD. For this project, I have assigned myself a fake homework assignment. Make a lighthearted dance song. You're sampling Smash Mouth's legendary multi-platinum all-star. Don't get distracted. Those are my two rules. You can't break those. It's simple enough, right? So what's going to happen is while I am working on this homework assignment, and you'll see me working on it on the screen, you as the audience get to act as my ADHD. So at any point in time, you can hold up a sign, and if I see it, I have to run over, trigger an appropriate sound, and then get back to work. So distract me as much as you want. I have never done this live before. I don't know if I'm going to finish in time. There's not even a time limit. Okay. Distractions 1 through 8 and 9 through 16. Now it's all 16 or over there. And that's how the setup works. So just hold your sign up and laugh at me. A weird picture of my friend in the background. You want to see it. It's pretty good, right? He wears that every day. Okay. Cool. Alright, so I'm gonna start. Now. What was that? Okay, hold on. check me out at SoundCloud. Somebody wants to tell me the world is coming over. Somebody wants to tell me the world is coming over. Somebody wants to tell me the world is coming over. Some, I hate the sharpest tool in the shed. She was looking kind of dumb with her finger and her thumb in the shape of an L. On her forehead. Hey now. Hey now. You have an old job. Hey now. Hey now. You have an old job. Hey now. Hey now. You have an old job. Hey now.
Is gold. Always shooting stars. Break the mold.
I'm honestly kind of totally fine with how this went. It's more endearing. It's me. It's more. It was a test of my improv skills. We'll say that. Okay. Okay, so now I would like to welcome back my roommate, my best friend, Casey Peter.